رحم الله من قرأ الفاتحة. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. الحمد لله الذي لم يتخذ ولدا ولم يكن له شريك في الملك ولم يكن له ولي من الذل وكبره تكبيرا. ثم الصلاة والسلام والتحية والإكرام على النبي الأمي المكي المدني سيدنا ومولانا ومولى الثقلين بالقاسم محمد. وعلى آل بيته الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين المظلومين الغر الميامين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. اللهم صل على محمد وآل محمد. واللعنة الدائمة على أعدائهم من حين عداوتهم إلى قيام يوم الدين. أما بعد، فقد قال الله الحكيم في كتابه الكريم وقوله الحق: بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. مثل الذين حملوا التوراة ثم لم يحملوها كمثل الحمار يحمل أسفارا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. صلوا على محمد وآل محمد. Respected brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. Azzam Allahu ujurana wa ujurakum bi musabina bi Abi Abdullah al-Husayn wa auladihi wa awanihi wa ansarih. The day of Arba'een, may Allah amplify in your commemoration and your grief of Aba Abdullah al-Husayn, his family and his companions, and accept this commemoration from all of us and give us opportunity so we may increase in that, so we will become worthy of receiving more reward and sawab and guidance through this commemoration. Brothers and sisters, during this series of 5 lectures so far, we have reached to this conclusion that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has created human being with intellect, and through this intellect, human being was able to recognize his creator, and after that, when his intellect progressed, he was able to find the purpose of the creation, which was mentioned through Quran, ibadat. And ibadat is nothing without ma'rifat, and ma'rifat is nothing and cannot be achieved without aql. So when human being reached to this conclusion, second thing which was important to practice the intellect, because possessing intellect is one thing and practicing on that intellect is something else which is more important, that human being was in need of ilm and knowledge. Because aql is talking about general things, and ilm comes and define the special things and the details of that things which were received through intellect. When aql came, through aql and ilm, we were able to discover that a human being is also in need of a guide or a divine messenger who will be able to explain the knowledge and ilm. Reason is, because when purpose of the creation is defined as worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, worship of the creator for someone who doesn't believe in gods and Allah, or believe in creator only, so recognition and worship of him demands, because it is the quality of that creator who is powerful, and intellect appeals that your creator should be powerful and the creator, so a person cannot have access to him, because we are the limited, we are having no power as compared to the power of our creator. Because if we had the power, intellect says, I was also a Khaliq. Whereas we see Khaliq or the creator, and for Muslimin, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the only who is ala kulli shay'in qadir. So to understand and to get awareness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we need a source, a mean. Because we are limited, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not having any physical appearance, any materialistic appearance, or anything which limitizes him. So then we are looking for, we are in need of the personalities who are having both aspects. In one aspect, they are connected with us, and we have a bit power or understanding and awareness to understand and to have connection with them. And on other side, they are the reflection of the creators. They are possessing the qualities which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given them the qualities. And this door is not closed. It is open for all of us. And we are commanded and we are advised that instead of possessing and acquiring the characteristics and qualities of shaitan, we should become the mirrors. We should try to acquire the qualities of God. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is hakim, wise. A mu'min should be wise also. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is kareem. He is generous. A mu'min should be generous. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is powerful. A mu'min should be powerful as well. So these are the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And on the face of earth, there are personalities appointed by him. They have acquired that status which is near to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now it is for us to follow them, to practice their commands and their rulings to reach Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So we have learned that after intellect, aql is very important, and for aql, after intellect, ilm, the knowledge is very important, and when ilm is there, we need someone to guide us and help us how to practice on that ilm and aql. So if we were able to understand, then inshallah the door of salvation is open for us. But what happens? I have quoted a couple of ahadith which are talking about the necessity of imamat through Islam. This was through intellect. But now talk about Islam. I'm talking about all schools of thought in Islam, not especially the school of thought which we are following, where many people among us are sitting here. But other schools of thought, they have this hadith and they believe that Prophet, peace be upon him, has said that whosoever dies and does not recognize the imam of his time is going to die as the death of ignorance. He will be die ignorant. Why? Because Quran is clearly saying, يَوْمَ نَدْعُ كُلَّ أُنَاسٍ بِإِمَامِهِمْ, that on that day, on the day of resurrection, everybody will follow his imam. So if people, they have not recognized their imam in this world, they will follow someone they don't know. So this is the problem. So now, ilm is there, intellect is there, and according to our belief, the guide and the divine messengers, which are the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, keep in your mind that hadith always, inna lillahi ala nasi hujjatain. There are two kinds, there are two categories of the proof for everyone from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hujjatun zahira, one is evident, who are the rasul, prophets and imams, and hujjat batina, aql. So hujjat zahira is there, hujjat batina is there, and hujjat zahira has commanded us to acquire the knowledge. Now we possess the knowledge and intellect. So are we guided or are we successful? So far we have explained that we have intellect, we have learned some things through Ahlul Bayt or the divine guides and the messengers, and now we know everything. Now we have the knowledge. So is it sufficient? So now let's dissect this. Because if you say that you have the knowledge and that is sufficient, it's a big mistake. How? We will prove later. First of all, I would say, if when this myth comes, a lot of people, they would say that ilm is synonym of iman. When you have ilm, it means you have iman. It means that if I know, I have the knowledge that there is one God, I have this knowledge, I have this ilm, there is only one God. It means that I have iman in one God. When I say that Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa alayhi wa sallam, is the last messenger of Allah, it means that I have iman and faith and belief in Rasulullah as last messenger. When I would say that Amirul Mu'mineen is the successor after the Prophet, I have this knowledge, it means that I believe in this. So sometimes we think that ilm, knowledge is equal to faith and iman. Whereas the reality says that we are not the only who knows that Allah is one. Many people who study about Islam, there are many non-Muslims, they know that Muslims, they believe God is one, or Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is the last messenger of Allah, and Ali ibn Abi Talib is the righteous successor after the Prophet, but they are not having iman. So reality is something different. So it tells us that ilm is something different than iman. Knowing something is not sufficient. Believing in that thing is very important. So that's why you see that alhamdulillah, we raise our kids in a way that first thing we teach them that tawheed. We teach them nubuwat, risalat, imamat, qiyamat, adl. We teach them, they know. But are they having iman in that, or they just know that? This is a big problem among our society. We have knowledge of many things, but we don't know and we don't have faith and believe in those things. And it is not common problem these days. It was always a big problem. And Quran has indicated about this thing that there are many people, they had knowledge, but they didn't practice on their knowledge. So that's why their knowledge is not only sufficient for them or beneficial for them, but it is harmful for them. Because knowledge becomes a great wall among them and their Lord. Knowledge becomes a great wall among them and their true iman. How? Quran has made the examples. For instance, there is a story in Quran mentioned about Iblis, the shaitan, devil, Satan. Iblis, when he was commanded, I'm not going to elaborate the whole story, all of you are aware of that, to save some time, I will just indicate the conversation which happened in between Iblis and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So Iblis is saying to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that whatever you are saying, I will do that. Because he used to perform a lot of worship. There are riwayat which are telling that he performed a lot of worship for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So he knew Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If he didn't know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, how he has done the worship? He knew that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is there. Another evidence is when he is having this dialogue, we didn't have any dialogue with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in one way, he was having even more knowledge than us, because he is having this dialogue that when Allah is saying that I have created human being, now perform sajda, now prostrate. And Iblis is saying, you can ask me anything, I will do that. But I will not prostrate in front of something which is made with a material which is lesser than me. So there are many lessons in the story of Iblis. One of the lessons is always try to avoid, try to keep yourself away from arrogance. Because it was the biggest example of the arrogance. Iblis is saying, I will not prostrate, I will not bow down. You would say, I have performed thousands of sajda and I will do prostrate all of my life to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But I will not do perform any prostration to Iblis. Result comes to us that it is not important that whatever we are following is our desire. It is important what Allah is commanding us to do. So Iblis' desire is saying that I am worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. How come I will prostrate in front of someone which is not Lord, which is not Khalik? But important thing is that don't care. Don't listen to your nafs that you are doing this for Allah, because it is Allah's command. He himself is saying, prostrate in front of Adam. So we learned this lesson. Iblis was aware of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but he became not among Muslims, not among the believers. He became among Munkirin. He denied. So here's one example of the people. They were having knowledge and very advanced knowledge, but they didn't have Iman. They didn't have faith and firm belief. Second example, the very first verse which I recited in the beginning, verse of Surah Jumu'ah, famous surah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ حُمِّلُوا التَّوْرَاتِ ثُمَّ لَمْ يَحْمِلُوهَا كَمَثَلِ الْحِمَارِ يَحْمِلُ أَسْفَارًا. In this verse, if you see the beauty of Quran, Quran has mentioned many beautiful words. There are two words which are especially in our society and among us doesn't look very appropriate to use and to speak. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has used and shows utmost disrespect to this group of people. They are doing this attitude. So Allah is saying, مَثَلُ الَّذِينَ حُمِّلُوا التَّوْرَاتِ. People of the Torah or Torah, their example is يَحْمِلُ أَسْفَارًا كَمَثَلُ الْحِمَارِ. They are just like the donkeys. How? Who are bearing, who are carrying asfara. They are carrying the books. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is giving the example of the scholars. Scholars of Torah. Scholars of the Judaism. At that time, they were very learned people. They knew everything. But they didn't practice on that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, although they are ulama, although they are alim, they are possessing ilm, but they don't have belief in that ilm. So their example is just like the donkeys. So it is an example for us and a warning for us. If we have knowledge, we should practice on that. We should have belief in that knowledge. If that is commanding us to do something, we have to follow that command. So this was the another example of ulama-i Yahud, or scholars of the Judaism. Same thing mentioned, very similar about Christianity as well. Quran is saying that Christian and Jews, their scholars especially, they knew the reality that there is a promised messenger. In second speech, I have mentioned regarding the story of Mubahalah, the people of Najran, I mentioned that there were many Christians and Jews living in Jerusalem, and they migrated from there to Mecca and Arabian Peninsula because their divine scriptures were saying that there will be last prophet, there will be last messenger, and they were waiting for him. They moved here, but after understanding, after learning about that prophet, they didn't accept him. They had the knowledge. Quran is saying, Quran is quoting this verse, and I believe that if you find there were many versions of the Bible, as you are aware, the current Bible which we have in our hands is not the divine book given by Allah to the Prophet Jesus. In fact, this is the version of the books which were written by the disciples of the Prophet Jesus, peace be upon him, and even later edited and altered and changed by many other scholars. So in fact, the original Bible was having very open and evident account of the story or news of the awaited messenger. Even in some versions which we have nowadays in our hand, this verse could be found in which the Christians are commanded that there will be a prophet mentioned. Quran is talking about that. The Bible is saying there will be a last messenger. Prophet Jesus is saying that there will be last messenger whose name will be Ahmad. يَأْتِ مِنْ بَعْدِ إِسْمُهُ أَحْمَدُ. And you know that the hadith or the very beautiful sermon which is said by many ulama from the pulpit, and you know that, which is saying سُمِّيَ فِي السَّمَاءِ بِأَحْمَدُ وَفِي الْأَرَضِينَ أَبِي الْقَاسِمِ مُحَمَّدُ. So they not only knew the prophet is coming, but they knew the detail. They knew the name of that prophet, but knowledge was not equal to their belief. So it is another example. I am quoting these examples repeatedly because we are also practicing in some regard this thing. We know many, many things. And we talk to people about many things. Oh, do you know there is a day which is coming ahead of us, we have to prepare, but are we preparing ourselves? We are asking many people. So something happens because we have the knowledge. We read a lot, but we do not practice. Read less, but practice more. It is more important. So the third example in Quran also, there are many examples, as I told you, in Quran, there are many examples of this thing that there were people itself, the verse of Mubahala, which is saying, فَمَنْ حَاجَ بِسْمِ اللَّهِ الرَّحْمَنِ الرَّحِيمِ فَمَنْ حَاجَكَ فِيهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا جَاءَكَ مِنَ الْعِلْمِ. The word is used, ilm, that they came to the Prophet and they are having argument, although they already have received the knowledge. They know it. And that's what I'm saying. Sometimes we know what is the reality, but still we are having argument. So at that time, Allah is saying that if after the ilm, they are having argument, then let's call them for mubahala. So it is a difficult situation. So these are three examples or four examples from Quran. We have day-to-day examples as well. We have knowledge of something, but we do not practice. Very interestingly, some of us or some of people sitting here, we see every day many people, they are having the disease of diabetes. May Allah cure everybody from this disease and give the quickest recovery. They are aware that they are having diabetes, but you ask them not to eat sweet, they will not follow your command. They will eat even more. They would say, now this is the difficulty, we didn't eat before, now we have to eat. So what happens? Don't they know that this is harmful for them? They know. A person who is taking insulin or any other medicine for the diabetes, but at the same time he is eating sweets double than an ordinary person, so it means that he has the knowledge, but he doesn't have the iman. He doesn't have that firm certainty that this disease could be harmful for me. He has the knowledge, but not practicing. Anyone who is having cholesterol, he knows there are a list of things which are prohibited for him, which may harm his body. But we see people, they are eating a lot of things which may harm their bodies. So these are the examples throughout the day and life. Beside the Quran, Quran is quoting some examples, and through our day-to-day life, we know we have the knowledge, but we do not practice on that knowledge. We don't have iman on that knowledge. So that's why when the religious matters come, we believe that if we are having knowledge, it is equal to iman. We think my son went to Sunday school and he has learned that Usul-e-Din are 5 and Furu-e-Din are 10. These are sufficient for him and I don't follow up. In fact, iman on these things is more important than knowing these things. If I say that there is no deity worship, there is no one worthy of worship except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then why I am afraid of my boss? Then why I am afraid while praying that someone will say something to me? I have to please Allah because I say this from my tongue that there is only one who is deity worship, who is sustainer, who gives me money. Then why I believe that good job will give me, good job will give me sustenance. Having good job is very good thing. Having a good profession is very good thing. But having belief in that and forgetting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the worst thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has encouraged us. Yes, get the best education, get the best job, get the best source of sustenance, halal, wasi', tayyib, but believe in Him. Maybe He will test you one day. Don't think that he is testing me. There are verses of Quran in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that when we are giving and we are testing, He says, see how beautifully He is treating me, how lover I am to Him, how respectful near Him. So when Allah is saying, but the same moment when I faqadara alayhi rizqa, when I tied Him through His sustenance, He says, My Lord has disgraced me. So this is our attitude. فَأَمَّا مَبْتَلَاهُ رَبَّهُ فَأَكْرَمَهُ فَيَقُولُ رَبِّي أَكْرَمًا. My Lord has given me grace. And when Allah is saying, فَقَدْرَ عَلَيْهِ رِزْقَ, He says, رَبِّي أَهَانًا. My God has done disrespect to me, disgrace to me. Allah is saying that I will test you by giving and I will test you by taking. Both situations are the test. Don't think if I have given you that you are very near to me. Sometimes Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is testing you by giving. Or if Allah is taking from you, Don't think that you have done something bad and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to punish you. This is wrong mentality. When we see sometimes people, they are not having good life physically or sometimes in the materialistic aspect, sometimes we have pity. See, Allah doesn't like him. If he would like him, he would have given him the best car, best house. But no, maybe that person is closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than yourself. So it is important to understand what God is saying, that follow his command with the ilm, have iman. So iman or certainty, if we talk about the worldly thing, that if someone is aware of the disease and the effects of the disease, if he is practicing, it means he is certain of that. And when this thing comes to the religion, we say that this person is having iman in Allah and this person is having ilm in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد Now a little bit difficult step comes. After listening to this, maybe many of you will think that ilm is bringing a trouble to us. You know, if we learn that there is God, there is a day on which we will be resurrected and we will be held accountable of the actions which we have done in this world, then let's forget about that. And very common slogan for long time, it was among the people and our communities, they had this misunderstanding that ignorance is the blessing. So don't learn things, because if you learn things, it will bring the responsibilities on you. So don't go to majalis, because you will learn about prayer, you will learn about fasting, you will learn about the message of Abdullah Hussain. Just sit home and don't learn anything, because if you learn, it will bring responsibility to you. So it was a myth, a misunderstanding. Because there is a very beautiful hadith by our sixth Imam, Imam Ja'far Sadiq alayhi salatu wassalam, which is condemning this. And he's saying, and we read this on very higher level when we go to Bahth al-Kharij in Fiqh and Usul. So this rule is taught that on the day of judgment, someone will be brought and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will question this person, Abdi, Kunta jahilan am aliman. O my slave, O my servant, were you aware or you were ignorant? You had knowledge or you were ignorant? So this person would say that I was alim, I knew the duty. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would say, if you knew that, then why you have not practiced? Second question. If you knew that, why you haven't practiced that? As I told you, we know many things. We know lying is bad, but we lie from day until morning, until dawn, until evening, until night. We know backbiting is bad, but we backbite people. We know cheating someone is bad, but we do that. Allah is saying, you knew that these things were forbidden, but you have done. And if someone would say, like someone like me who would say that, if I say that I didn't know, Allah will release me, I would say, no, I didn't know that. Then Allah would say, why you didn't go to learn that? It is more important. You had the opportunity. You were sent to this world. You were having intellect. You were having prophets. You were having guidance. And you didn't learn. There is no argument or reason acceptable. There are two kinds of jahil. There are two kinds of ignorant person. What are those categories? One, jahil qasir. Other is jahil muqassir. Jahil qasir means that he tried his best to learn something, but he was unable to get the guidance. And jahil muqassir means that he was having this opportunity to learn something, but he didn't learn. Jahil qasir means someone, maybe you think about like 150 years back, someone is living in Alaska and there is no satellite, no TV, no newspaper, no radio, and that person didn't receive any guidance. So that person may say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala on the day of judgment, yes, I was ignorant and message was not received to me. I tried to learn, but I was living in snow and there was no life. We were only 200 people and whatever the best we tried to do, we did. But no message was received, no education was received. Maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will treat that person in a separate way. But a person like us, especially in this day and age, when a person is asked, if I ask that person that while you have not learned about Islam or why you haven't educated yourself about the good deeds, that person would say, no, message of Islam, message of truth, message of good things were not reached to me. But if I ask same person, I am traveling to Bali tomorrow, give me the address of a good hotel, he will give me 10 addresses and 10 good deeds, good deals, and would say that mention me, it will give me some kickbacks as well. He hasn't visited, but this is the blessing of this time, that he knows that if someone wants to make a trip to Bali, which is thousands of miles away from here, he knows that how to look for a good deal, but he doesn't want to search about Islam. It's an excuse which is not acceptable. So ilm brings the responsibility, but ignorance is worst, because ilm gives you the opportunity that you learn and you practice. But if you are ignorant, then even this opportunity is taken away from you. So that's why our masumeen, they have said that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will treat with justice. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of the very beautiful beliefs which we have, that adalat. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will treat us with justice. If we were not given the opportunity, as last night I have mentioned, that it doesn't mean that we believe that knowing about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or the messengers or imam is difficult, so leave everything on side. No, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will treat us with justice. Whatever opportunity we were given, we will be held accountable according to that. Whatever opportunity is given, we have to practice, we have to strive, we have to make our maximum effort to utilize that. So there is no reason to say that I was not given chance in this world. Everybody has given a chance in this world. Everybody has received the guidance in this world. If we are lazy, we are thinking about the worldly and materialistic things, then we are going to have a very difficult exam in hereafter. But if we have understood that a life which is ahead of us, the means of success in that life are provided in this world, and we have to select, we have to choose, we have to collect those means, inshallah Allah will give us the salvation. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ali Muhammad. Now, we have iman, we have aql, we have ilm. For instance, may Allah give all of us all these three things. For instance, we have taken all of these things. The intellect which we had, on the base of that, we learned the knowledge, and the knowledge which we had, we have firm belief and iman on that. So we are stick with the messengers and the guides of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So they are in front of us. As I told you, Hujjat al-Zahira, in that hadith, Allah is saying, Prophet, Nabi and Imam, they are my proof and evidence. But someone from this time would stand up and would say that, O Allah, among your proofs, among your hujjat, Quran was in front of me. But Prophet has said that I am leaving behind myself two precious things. Kitab Allah wa itrati ahlu bayti. I didn't have ahlu bayt. I didn't see them. Physically, they were not present in front of me. So, I didn't receive your hujjah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, before putting his hujjat in occultation, he has provided the source in his absence for us. There are rivayat. In fact, if we leave that sources aside, there are rivayat. In occultation, Imam is giving you the benefit equal to as you are having the benefit of sun behind the clouds. No matter how many clouds are there, you can't see the sun sometimes when there are thick clouds. But you know it is day, you are getting the warmth of that sun, you are getting the light of that sun. So Imam in occultation is similar to sun behind the clouds. We are getting benefit of that. So that proof or that argument is not acceptable. Even Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying that we have raised your status. Why? Because Bismillah ar-Rahman ar-Rahim, Surah Al-Baqarah, Alif Lam Mim, Dhalika al-Kitabu, La Rayba Fi Hudan al-Muttaqeen, Alladhina Yu'minuna Bil-Ghayb. The people who are having belief in hidden things. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is hidden. Our trust Imam, Hujjatullah, which is Hujjat for us. All Aima and Prophet are Hujjat for us. We cannot have this argument. A person who was living during the time of sixth Imam, he was having evident Hujjat in front of him. But I am not having Hujjat in front of me. So I am not having any argument of proof. So Allah would say, no, I have given you the hujjat, and as the compensation, I told you your status is higher. That's why we have the ahadith which are saying ordinary people of Akhir Zaman are better than the people and Anbiya of Banu Israel. So see your status, see your station. Allah is saying the people of Akhir Zaman are better than the Anbiya of Banu Israel. Why? Because they have believed in one, they haven't seen him. Have we seen Imam Hussain alayhi salatu wasalam? But all of us will believe in him. Have we seen our Imam Al-Hujja alayhi salatu wasalam? Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Oh. But all of us, we are having belief in him. We pray for his reappearance. We pray that, oh Allah, count us, consider us among his companions. So inshallah, Allah will listen to our prayers and we will be among his companions and soldiers inshallah one day. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made another arrangement beside these two, three things which I have mentioned. Allah has not left aside. As I told you, Rabbil Alameen, the first characteristic which we learned through Surah Al-Fatiha, Alhamdulillahi Rabbil Alameen, that he is Rabb. So he is thinking for the people, they are having evident Imam, and he is thinking also, and he has provided something for the people, they will not have present Imam. What is that? During the time of Prophet, I am not talking about this time, which is the time of our living Imam, this is the time of 12th Imam, even before that, many years before that, during the time of Prophet, when Prophet himself is among the people, Surah Tawbah is revealing a verse, which is called in Quran Kareem Ayah Nafr, which is saying that فَلَوْ لَا نَفَرَ مِنْ كُلِّ فِرْقَةٍ, from among all nations, there should be someone who should go لِيَتَفَقَّهُ فِي الدِّينِ, to learn about the religion. لِيَتَفَقَّهُ, understanding, the deep understanding of the knowledge. And when he returns back to his nation, he may warn the people. So this is the duty of the people during the time of occultation of Imam, that among people, there should be a group of people, there should be some individual, not all, because all cannot go, because all cannot be an alim, all cannot be mujtahid, because we need in society, we need doctor, we need engineer, we need other people as well. But among every nation, among the groups of people, there should be some people to go learn about Islam, learn about deen, and return back and may warn the people about the teachings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the verse of Quran, very evident. And when someone went to our Imam and asked, who are those people? And Imam said, فَأَمَّا الْحَوَادِثِ الْوَاقِعَةِ, whenever an affliction comes to you or a problem comes to you, فَرْجِعُوا إِلَىٰ رُوَاتِ أَحَادِيثُنَا, it is your duty to return back or to explain your problems and get guidance from the people who are protecting and who are reporting our ahadith. So these are the ulama, these are the scholars, these are the mujtahideen, these are the people. When Imam is not there, Imam is in occultation, Prophet is not physically among us, he is there always. Imam is there always, there is no doubt. We believe always he is with us. Always we are under his surveillance, no matter where we are. As Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is witness of us, our Imam and our Hujjat is witness of us. During the time of day and night, during the time of death, during the time of birth, he is with us always. But since we don't have physical, very physical connection, so Imam is saying that find the people who are possessing our knowledge. They have strived to protect our knowledge. Ask your troubles from them. Seek guidance from them. There is another hadith by our 11th Imam, Imam Hassan al-Askari alayhi salatu wasalam. Which is talking about this issue very eloquently. They are talking about the qualities. Because you know, as I have mentioned, Quran has condemned some scholars. Quran has praised some scholars. Quran has condemned some scholars. Those scholars are the people who are not practicing on their religion. Because I told you, if a doctor is a very good doctor, and you go to his clinic and you see that he's smoking, you will not go to him. And if you have a dentist and you will see that dentist is not having any tooth, so you will not go for treatment. Because you will say, if he was unable to treat himself, then how he will treat you? or a person like me who is bald, he will not go to someone for hair transplantation or transplant that is not having the hair. So we know that we should not go to the alim who is not practicing on that knowledge, whose action is absolutely against to what he is talking about, whose action are absolutely against about the teachings of Islam. So we will not go to them. So our Masumeen, they have given us a criteria. They have given us the scale that our 11th Imam in this hadith, he is saying that every person, every faqih who is having these five qualities, if you find them, then go and follow them. أَمَّا مَنْ كَانَ مِنَ الْفُقَهَا. If you find among our faqih, if you find among our scholars, سَائِنًا لِنَفْسِهِ, who are taking care of themselves. It is very difficult because Allah has given us the intellect, but we are not taking care of our souls. We know that listening to a haram music will not only bring a severe punishment for us in hereafter, but it will have bad effect in this world as well. But sometimes we do that. We were unable to safeguard ourselves. I'm not saying, yes, everybody is infallible. Tomorrow you will not do anything because I have said that every mu'min should not commit any sin. Allah is saying, I know that you are human beings and human beings will do sin. But the best among those human beings who are doing sin is someone who is doing repentance to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah is saying, if you have done sins, no problem. I will forgive you. Come, say, two rakat prayer of tawbah and say, oh Allah, I will not repeat that, provided this is sincere tawbah. Because sometimes we do tawbah and in our subconscious we are saying, we will do that again. No, tawbah should be sincere. Every time a person has committed sin, Allah's rahmat is wasi'a. Because I have told you that Allah will not treat us with justice. We hope this, especially for His punishment, that He will forgive us. He will have mercy on us. Because one of the laws which we learn through Quran, these laws are saying, as we are talking about intellect and knowledge as well, these laws are saying that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is just and He will treat us with justice. But if we see that if He treats us with justice, there is no concept of jaza. There is no concept of in'am, the favor, the reward, the prize. Maybe you will be shocked. Why? There is a concept of punishment, but through intellect, we cannot find the concept of reward. Why? Because when we say that we are created as a slave, as a servant, then whatever our master is saying, it is our job, it is our duty. If I have done that for my boss, then I have fulfilled my duty. There is no reward for that. But if I haven't done, then there should be a punishment. In our day-to-day life, if you are employed by someone, if you are fulfilling the requirement of your job, it is your duty because you are paid for that. But if you don't do that, you will be punished. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is so Rahman, so Rahim, that when we are doing His worship, we are fulfilling our command, He is rewarding us with the great reward. I give you the example, maybe for our youth, it will be good to understand through an example. For instance, all of you, most of you have driven here with your cars. On returning back home, you are driving back and very first light, the red light, you stop there because light is red and you wait to get that light green. And when you drive from that light, when it turns into green, you go almost few minutes drive, you see a cop is going on. He is driving. You go and horn and stop the cop. So it happens sometimes. Usually cop stops us, but you will stop the cop. Wait a minute, I have a question. That cop stops. He comes out. Yes, sir, what is the problem? The problem is, give me a price. That would say, what does it mean? You will say, give me a price. For what? Because I stop on red light. He would say, are you crazy? Are you in senses? You stop on red light. What does it mean that should I give you a price? I would say, that if I have crossed that red light, then you will give me the ticket. Since I am stopped there, now you give me the price. He would say it was your responsibility to stop on red light. So you have done your responsibility, yes. If you have crossed that red light and you didn't stop, then I will give you the ticket for sure. But if you stop there, don't ask me for the price. Same thing. If Allah has commanded us for something, if we have done, we shouldn't be looking for the reward. It is the rule of the intellect. Because it was our duty, we have performed our duty. But if I have violated the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I should be worthy of the punishment. I should receive the punishment, but it is the grace of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Although we are doing our job, but He will reward us with the best reward. And even when we violate His law, He says that you are having 10 tickets, you have violated overspeeding, you have violated 10 traffic lights, but come and say Tawbah and I will cancel all tickets. Who does this in this world? This is Rahmaniyat of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sallu ala Muhammad wa ala Muhammad. This is mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why Amir al-Mu'mineen is saying, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, don't deal with me according to your justice, but deal with me according to your rahmah. Because the rahmah, your rahmah wasa'at ghazaba. This is so broad. It will take over on your punishment and wrath. So we are having this hope in His rahmat. We don't have anything to present, but remember, yes, tawbah is accepted provided it is with the conditions. But tawbah in hukukul ibad, it is associated with hukukul ibad. If hukukullah, something is missed, something is done wrong, and we have done the sincere tawbah, Allah will forgive us. But hukukul ibad, until that person has forgiven us, Allah will not forgive. So be careful about hukukul ibad. Whatever we have taken away from the right of people, backbiting, stealing from someone, cheating someone, these are connected with the people. Be careful from the day of judgment. Before that, ask for forgiveness from the people. And when people, they have forgiven us, we believe in the big mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And beside that, we have believed in the intercession of Ahlul Bayt. That if we had deficiency in our actions, with the grace of Ahlul Bayt, with the tears which we have shed in their grief, they will be able to provide us the source of salvation. Our coming to the majalis, grieving for Abu Abdullah al-Hussein and his family and the companion, is having a great worth. It is having a great weight. They have commanded us to connect it with Maraja, with Fuqaha. They are Sa'iman li Nafsi, Hafiz al Lidin, Muti'an li Amri Mawla. The people, the Maraja, the Mujtahideen, who have these qualities, we have to stick with them, we have to follow them. But on the day of judgment, beside whatever we have done, we will be looking for these tears back, which we have shed in these days and nights. Allahu Akbar. These are the nights of Arba'een, brothers and sisters. السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله السلام عليك يا ابن رسول الله السلام عليك يا ابن أمير المؤمنين Peace and salutations be upon you, O grandson of the Prophet, peace be upon him. السلام عليكم يا أهل بيت النبوة O the household of the Prophet, peace and blessings be upon you. These are the days and nights of the grief of the people who are taken as the captives to Kufa and Sham. أجركم على الله. Brothers and sisters, we have recited the Masaib and the sermon of Sayyid Sajjad yesterday. After delivering that eloquent sermon, people of Sham, they were changed. There was a revolution. Yazid ibn Muawiyah was restless. He was unable to face people. And one day he sends a messenger to the prison. And that messenger knocks the door of the prison. And Zainab says, who is there? Messenger says, I am messenger of Yazid and he is calling for Sayyid Sajjad. Zainab would say, I will not let him go with you. I have to protect him. Ajrukum Allah. Sayyid Sajjad says, oh my aunt Zainab, let me go and see what Yazid says. Sayyid Sajjad goes and sees that Yazid is respecting him now. Yazid says, Assalamu alayka yabna Rasulullah. Yazid offers him to sit with him on the throne. And Sayyid Sajjad says, oh Malhoon, oh cursed one, how I can sit on the throne where underneath you have put the head of my father. Ajrukum Allah. Brothers and sisters, Yazid says, oh Sayyid Sajjad, oh Ibn Rasulullah, I have decided to make you free. I am going to release you from the prison. Now you have option. If you want, you can stay here in Damascus and we will provide everything. And if you want, you can go back to Medina. Sayyid Sajjad says, I will talk to my aunt Zainab because he is the one who led us from Karbala to Kufa and from Kufa to Sham. Sayyid Sajjad goes and asks Sayyid Zainab. She says, oh my son, present three wishes, present three demands, and I would say, oh Zainab, our salutations be upon you. Yazid was thinking that he has defeated you, but who gives the demands? A successor, a person who is successful gives the demand. Sayyid Zainab presented three demands. Sayyid Sajjad came to the court of Yazid. Yazid, my aunt Zainab is saying that I have three demands. Yazid is saying, ask your demands. Sayyid Sajjad is saying, my aunt Zainab is saying, since we were taken as the captives until today, we were not given chance to commemorate. Ajrukum Allah. See the luxury and comfort of this hall and this Imam Barga, that you can commemorate, you can shed your tears. But Sayyid Zainab, when these other ladies, they were not allowed to cry on Abu Abdullah al-Husayn, they were whips and lashes on their back if they would cry for Sayyid Sajjad, for Sayyid Abu Abdullah al-Husayn. Ajrukum Allah. So Sayyid Sajjad said, provide us with a house so we may grieve, we may commemorate the oppression which you have made and shahadat and martyrdom in that reserve. So Sayyid is saying, I will give you a house. Sayyid Sajjad is saying, now other demand is that whatever your army has looted from us, we want this tabarrukat back. Yazid is saying, whatever I have, I will give you back. And what is your third demand? Sayyid Sajjad says, give the heads of shuhada back. There are two riwayat. According to one riwayat, that heads were not given. But other riwayat says that heads were given to Ahlul Bayt. And when they were in that house, the ladies of Sham were there. And Sayyid Zainab conducted the first majlis, and she is reciting the masail of Karbala herself, and women are crying. And the same moment when the belonging and trust of Ahlul Bayt is coming, it arrived. When they open it, the first thing among first things, there was a alam of Abbas. Sayyida Zainab kissed that alam. Sayyida Sajjad, take this alam and put on the roof of this house, and we will grieve under the alam of Sabal Fazlul Abbas. And then Sayyida Zainab brought another tabarruk, another belonging of Ahlul Bayt, and that was the shirt smeared in the blood. Sayyida Sajjad is saying, whose shirt is this? Zainab is saying, this shirt was made by my mother, Sayyida Zahra Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. And when she was sewing this, when she was making this shirt, she would cry and would say, my son Hussein will be slaughtered on the plains of Karbala, and his blood will be shed on this shirt. Ajrukum Allah. Ajrukum Allah. After that, according to the narration, one heads are coming, one by one heads are coming. The head of Ali ibn al-Akbar came. Umm Layla went ahead, took the head of her son, kissed Ali ibn al-Akbar. Umm Farwa went and took the head of Qasim and kissed the head of Qasim. And heads are coming, and everyone who belongs to or is the relative of that head of Shaheed is taking and kissing the head. And suddenly many people they saw that there are two young hands are coming and no one is receiving. Someone said, say no, these are the hands of Honor Muhammad. Take the hand. Zainab is saying, I have given these hands to the way of Abadillah. Ajrukum Allah. Everyone cried. They commemorated the majlis. Now this is the time to leave. This is time to depart from Medina, from Damascus to Medina. And the caravan was prepared. Ajrukum Allah. Ajrukum Allah. Caravan was prepared. Caravan was about to leave. Zainab said, oh my son Sajjad, take this caravan to that prison. I have left an amanat there. My young daughter Sakina, she is all alone. Zainab goes to the grave. She calls upon the women of Damascus and says, oh ladies, I am leaving behind my 3 or 4 years old daughter. She was so thirsty on the day of Ashura. Whenever you get a chance, come and pour some water on the grave of Sakina. Maybe it will quench the thirst of Sakina. Ajrukum Allah. Then Zainab says, Oh noble woman, you know she was too young. And young kids, they are afraid of darkness. Whenever you find time, bring a torch or a candle and put on the little grave of Sakina. Ajrukum Allah. May Allah not give you any grief except grief of Abadullah. Maybe this is the last night when we are the able, when we are the among the people who are commemorating Abadullah Hussain. Try to shed a couple of tears. This will become a source of salvation. Ajrukum Allah. Ajrukum Allah, brothers and sisters. After that, this caravan is going towards Medina. But Sayyidah Zainab says, oh my son Sajjad, we will go first to Karbala. I want to visit my brother Hussain. Ajrukum Allah, I want to visit him. And on the other side, when the news of the martyrdom of Abdullah Hussain reached in the Medina, and people of Medina, they were restless. Among those people, there is one companion of the Prophet. His name is Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. Very noble, very great companion, very loyal companion. All of us, we read his name whenever we read the hadith al-Qisa. We say, I'm Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari. It's his status, Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, when he learns that grandson of Rasulullah is brutally massacred on the plains of Karbala. He takes one of his companions, Atiyah, and they go to the Karbala. And on the day of Arba'in, they are arriving in Karbala. They are the first visitors of the grave of Abadullah al-Hussain. When Jabir approaches to Karbala, it was the day of Arba'in. Jabir has become so old and he is saying, I am becoming blind. Oh my companion Atiyah, take me to the river of Euphrates. I want to take the ghusl. And he takes him to the Euphrates, he takes the ghusl. And when they return back, Jabir says, Oh Atiyah, take me to the grave of Abadullah al-Hussain. He says, I don't know, there are graves, there is no name on the grave. How I can take you to the grave of Abadullah? Jabir says, take my hand and take me among the graves and leave me alone. Atiyah takes the hand of Jabir ibn Abdullah and stands him in between the cover. He says, As-salamu alayka ya Abadullah. As-salamu alayka ya Abna Rasulullah. And a call comes, wa alayka as-salam ya Ammi Jabir. Oh my uncle Jabir, peace be upon you. Jabir says, Atiyah, take me to that grave. Jabir goes to that grave, falls himself on the grave, cries so much, and falls in unconsciousness. When he was on the grave, he had a dream that he has seen on the dream that Sayyidah Sajjad, Abadullah al-Hussain, his body is full of the arrows. And he says, oh my Imam, this was the body
This was the neck where Rasulullah used to kiss. I have seen with my eyes. Ajrukum Allah. He was having a conversation with Abdullah. Suddenly Abdullah is saying, now leave the grave. Jabir says, oh Imam, have I done that disrespect? He said, no, my sister, my son Sayyid Sajjad are coming. Go and receive them. Jabir comes in consciousness. Jabir stands up from the grave and Atiyah comes the same while. I have seen from the side of Sham, there is a cloud of dust. It appears that Yazid learns that we are here, so maybe they are going to kill us. Jabir says, go and find who are those people. The dust settles. Atiyah goes and sees a caravan is coming, and there are covered saddles on these rides, and this caravan is led by an old person. There is very old person. He comes and reports back to Jabir. Jabir, I have seen that a caravan is coming, and it appears there is no male because the saddles are covered, but ahead of that caravan there is very old man, even older than you. I can see that man. Jabir says, take me to that. Jabir goes, approach, and who are you? Sayyid Sajjad says, Ammi Jabir, you haven't recognized me. He said, oh my son, your dad played in my lap. You should be very young. But Atiyah says, I can't see. He is saying, your eyebrows are gray. Your back is more proud. Your hairs are gray. Ajrukum Allah. Ajrukum Allah. This is the day of Arba'een. Maybe this will be the last Arba'een. May Allah give all of you long life and life in the command of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. May Allah accept your knees. This may be the last, as I know all of you are tired. You have grieved over Abdullah Hussain for long days. But bring in your mind Sayyidah Zainab, Sayyidah Sajjad. Ajrukum Allah. Ajrukum Allah. Ajrukum Allah. Inna Lillah. Brothers and sisters. Brothers and sisters. Asadawa Sayyidah Masloom. Abdullah Hussain, son Sayyidah Sajjad says, oh Ammi Jabir, Hahuna, Zubiha Atfalina. This was the place where our kids were slaughtered. This was the place where my infant brother Ali Ibn Asghar was shot by 3-pronged arrow. This was the place where my brother Ali Ibn Akbar shot with a spear. And this was the place where grandson of Rasulullah, my father Hussein, he was slaughtered with a blunt dagger. Ajrukum Allah. Ajrukum Allah. One by one, Sayyid Sajjad gave the account of the day of Ashura to Jabir. Jabir was crying. Jabir was listening. This was the place where hands of Abul Fazl al-Abbas were severed. This was the place where Habib ibn Muzahir fell down. This was the place where body of Qasim ibn al-Hasan was trampled with the hooves of the horses. And after that, Jabir is saying, are you coming alone? He's saying, no, my aunt Zainab is with me. They leave the place. Zainab comes. She goes to the grave of Hussein. Oh, brother Hussein. Oh, Gharib Hussein. Zainab is back. Zainab says, I am very happy. And same thing, I am very grieved. I am very upset. Hussein, I am happy because I have won that mission. I am victorious and I have fulfilled the demand which you, my prophet, has made, and the mission which you started. I accomplished that mission. I am very happy on that. But I am very sad. I am very upset. You gave me a trust to take care. You gave me a trust to serve God. Your trust, Sakina, who would sleep on your chest. I left her alone in Zindan Ajal. She will stay there. Inna Lillah. Inna Lillah.
إنا إليه راجعون. وسيعلم الذين ظلموا أي منقلب ينقلبون. With having tears in your eyes, this is the time of acceptance of the prayers. Whatever problem you have, whatever affliction is fallen upon you, whatever problem you have, this is the time to ask for the solutions. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala may shower His mercy on all mu'mineen and on all of us. May Allah accept our commemoration. May Allah give us the best reward for this commemoration. May Allah forgive our major and minor sins. May Allah give quickest recovery to our marees and in people. May Allah accept our hajat and forgive the sins of our parents. If they are alive, may Allah give them the long life. And in the end, I pray especially for the mu'mineen who are suffering, like mu'mineen of Pakistan, mu'mineen of Iraq, mu'mineen of Syria, and anywhere in this universe there are the followers and the people who say Hussein, Hussein, and Ali, Ali. May Allah protect them. May Allah safeguard their lives, their wealth, their honor. May Allah forgive us. May Allah forgive all of the shuhada and sulaha. May Allah raise their status. Especially I pray for the reappearance and hastening in reappearance of our Imam Al-Hujjah alayhi salatu wassalam. May Allah give us this opportunity so we may include it among his companions and among his supporters, and we may be able to see his face and become among his supporters. In the end, for his reappearance, hastening in his reappearance, recite Dua-e Faraj all together. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. Allahumma salawatuka alayhi wa ala abai fi hadhihi sa'ah wa fi kulli waliya wa hafiza wa qaida wa nasira wa dalila wa aina hatta tuskinahu ardaka tawwa wa tumatti'ahu fiha tawila برحمتك يا أرحم الراحمين. صلوا على محمد وعلى محمد. حسين 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 حسين
حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين حسين Hussain, 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 Hussain.
She was the daughter of Amir al-Mu'mineen, a shining sun like her grandfather, the one described.